So here's the program on the Complexity Explorer site that will make time series plots for the Hénon map. This is the same program that we used in Unit 7. Links to this program and all the other programs from this unit are collected in a segment called, or a subunit called, something like Links to Programs. It's there in the right-hand navigation bar. We'll be using a bunch of different programs in this unit. All right, so time series plots for the Hénon map. We were looking at 0.8 for A. So I'll use 0.8 for A, 0.3 for B, and let's make the time series plot. There it is. That's what I showed you a screen capture of previously. And you can look at the phase space, or the XY plot. And we're seeing a lot of transient behavior as it sort of bounces around before it gets to the final value. So if we want to think of this as a final state diagram, just looking at the long-term behavior, let's go back up here and, I don't know, I'll have it plot 4,000 iterates, and I'm going to have it skip all but the last 50, so 3950. So it'll plot in the time series plot 4,000, but on the XY plot it'll only do the last 50 because it will skip the first 3,950. So let's do that. It takes a little while to plot all those points and we'll get this big purple blob. There it is. Let's go down here and we can see indeed that the long-term behavior is just those two fixed points, two periodic points. So here's the one that is about minus 0.38 plus 0.38. That's right over here. And we drew that in pen in the previous video. And here is the other point, the other periodic point, 1.28 or 1.26 and minus 1.2. So notice that the zero axis, right, is here and then here. So final state diagram period 2, we see two dots just like we did for the logistic equation. It's just that now the two dots live in a plane instead of on a line. We'll now look at the Hénon map for a different parameter value. I'll let A equal 1.4, which is the default on this program. These are the parameter values that Hénon considered when he first did this work. So we've done this before, but we'll do it again. Let's make the time series plot. And we see some apparently aperiodic behavior. Certainly looks chaotic. We're used to seeing shapes kind of like this from our study of the logistic equation. So then we can ask, all right, what do these points look like if we plot them in the xy plane? For a periodic value, we saw that we just got two points. And in that case, the two-dimensional picture was the same as the one-dimensional picture. So periodic with period 2, there'll be two points in the final state diagram. That's the long-term behavior. And it doesn't really matter if those two points are on a line, like they were for the logistic map, or on a plane, like they are for the Hénon map. So what if we plot the x and y values against each other for this? For the logistic equation, when we did that, we saw that they filled up the line interval. Just the dots kept getting denser and denser and denser on that line. So we might expect to see a similar sort of blob that the points will fill up a two-dimensional space, that the grid will just eventually get completely covered in with dots left and right, up and down. So let's see if that is indeed the case. So here are the two time series, and here are the points plotted in the XY plane. There are just 40 of them, so we can't really see that much what's going on, but I guess the thing to note is that it doesn't appear that they're moving about just at random here. There's a whole region in here where there are no points at all. It looks like it's making some sort of a pattern. So let's ask the computer to plot more points. I guess I'll do what I did before. 4,000, but this time I'm going to skip just the first 50. So we'll ignore the first 50, then plot Another 3,000. Let me do this 2,000. Let's be safe. So it's going to calculate 2,000 iterates, and it will plot all but the first 50. So the computer is thinking. There it is. All right. So the time series plots look like sort of what we're used to for chaotic time series plots. It's an aperiodic orbit. It's bouncing all over the place. Big purple blobs. But let's see what happens down here. And here we're seeing that what we suspected before is indeed the case, that it is not the case that these blue points fill up this entire grid. Instead, they seem to be filling up this sort of sideways U, or I don't know, to me it looks like a boomerang, but this weird sort of shape here. So this shape, the thing we're looking at, is a strange attractor. So let me say a little bit about what a strange attractor is, and then I'll illustrate that graphically in a number of different ways. So a strange attractor. The first thing about a strange attractor is it's an attractor. That seems sort of obvious, but it's worth remembering. And what that means is that nearby points get pulled into this shape. So we've seen cycles that were attractors, and that means that all or almost all initial conditions get pulled into that attractor. It's the same thing here. It's an attractor. Nearby initial conditions will all get pulled into it, but now the attractor is chaotic. It's not periodic like the attractors we've seen before. Okay, so that's the second thing about strange attractors, is that the motion on the attractor is chaotic. And the other point for the Hénon map that I want to emphasize is that these points, as we do iterate 1, iterate 2, iterate 3, they jump around on this. So this ends up being a smooth curve, and I'll show you a better picture in a second, but the points don't move in a smooth way. And we can see that, we can see that here. The points aren't moving around in any sort of smooth way, x versus t, y versus t. And so if we were to plot this in slow motion, we'd see a dot here, and a dot here, and a dot there, and then only gradually would this shape emerge out of the mist. So I have much more to say or to show you about this attractor, but first I want to verify this claim I made that motion on the attractor is chaotic. So to do that, we'll open up another program, and the link to that is also in the navigation bar on the right, links to programs. It's the second one under the Hénon map. And what we'll do is we'll plot two different initial conditions, and we'll look for evidence of the butterfly effect. So here's that other program. This will also calculate time series plots for the Hénon map. It'll also make plots in XY space. But now it will do so for two different initial conditions, and we'll plot them in different colors. This is very similar to the program that we used for the logistic equation when we were looking for evidence of sensitive dependence on initial conditions, the butterfly effect. So again, I'll let the parameter be 1.4, parameter A, and then B will be 0.3. And here are two different initial conditions, 0.2, 0.2, and 0.21, 0.21. So very close initial conditions. And let's make the time series plot. All right. So here is just the X time series. And this general phenomena, I hope, looks somewhat familiar. The two itineraries for two different initial conditions are plotted in green and purple. And they start off right on top of each other. But pretty quickly, after about 10 or 12 time steps, they move apart. And after that, they're behaving completely differently. Although, notice they kind of come back in alignment here, and then they go out of alignment there. And we saw that general phenomenon in the logistic equation, too. Similar story in the y versus t graph that we're seeing, two nearby initial conditions start off right on top of each other, but they get pulled apart. Let me show this a little bit more dramatically. I'll do what I did before. And now the initial conditions are really close, one part in a thousand or something. So the initial conditions are 0.2, 0.2, 0.2001, 0.2001. And I might have to go out a little farther. Let's do 100 iterations, make the time series plot. There it is. Didn't need to go out that far. I'll do 50. Here we go. Okay. So similar to what we've seen before, I increased the similarity between the two. Sorry, let me say it another way. I decreased the difference between the two initial conditions. Now they're very, very close. And indeed, we can predict farther if we're viewing green as a prediction and purple as reality or vice versa. But increasing the resolution or the accuracy by a factor of 1,000 only let us double or not even quite triple our prediction time. So again, this is the butterfly effect. Very, very small differences in initial conditions eventually make a very large difference in the behavior of the orbits. And we see a similar story for Y. All right, but now let's see, how does this play out in the XY plot? So there it is, and notice that the green and the purple are both filling up, they're both starting to trace out the same shape. So let me try to illustrate this point. I go back here. Again, I'm going to do 2,000, and I'm going to skip 50 iterations. Actually, maybe let me just do 1,000. I'll skip 50. So the computer will think for a moment. There are the two time series, purple and green, right on top of each other, familiar-looking mess. And there is the Hénon attractor. So we see that the initial conditions, okay, they started off the same, but we know that the butterfly effect pushes them apart very quickly. And so we're seeing two different initial conditions ending up at the same shape. It looks like there's more green than purple because green is blotted second. So a lot of there are a lot of purple points underneath the green points. So again, what we have here is chaotic behavior, aperiodic. Let's see, it's a deterministic dynamical system. Orbits are bounded. They're aperiodic, and they have sensitive dependence on initial conditions. But we also have this attractor structure. And attractors indicate some type of stability. Different initial conditions end up at the same attractor. But here the attractor is this funny bent shape in two-dimensional space, and the motion on the attractor is chaotic, whereas previously the motion on attractors, like a period 4 attractor, has not been chaotic, it's been periodic. Let me do one more thing to illustrate in just a slightly different way this phenomenon of an attractor that itself is chaotic. So I'm back to the program that plots the time series and the XY plot from just one initial condition. And I'm going to ask it to do, let's have it do 500, and I'm going to skip the first 50. So here we go, I make the plots. There they are. X and Y, both aperiodic, but plotted together, they appear quite ordered. It's this sideways U or boomerang shape again. All right. So if I change the initial condition, let's say I change initial X from 0.2 to 0.7. So if I do that, that's going to make this X plot look quite different because I have a different initial condition. So let's see that. Watch this plot down here change. But the plot down there looks the same. The points might be in a slightly different place, like there might be a point here instead of there, but the general structure of this shape is independent of the initial condition. And that's just another way of saying it's an attractor. Multiple initial conditions end up on this shape. Once they're on the shape, they bounce around chaotically. All right, let's do this maybe just for one more. I don't know, let's get a better view of the attractor. I'll plot 1,000. Let's try an initial condition of 0.6. So there's the time series, but there's that shape again. And if I change this to 0.66, the time series plot right below will be different. Sensitive dependence on initial conditions, there it is, that just changed, will give me a different time series. But the attractor structure stays the same. The exact points that you might visit on this shape will be a little bit different because of the butterfly effect, because of sensitive dependence on initial conditions. But the set of points that are available to bounce around on this attractor stay the same. So again, this is a strange attractor. It is a stable structure in that it's an attractor. Lots of orbits get pulled to it, but once one is on the attractor, the motion is chaotic, aperiodic, and it has sensitive dependence on initial conditions. So what I want to do next is go to a different program that will let us zoom in, plot many, many points, and zoom in on the structure of the attractor, and we'll see some of what is deep inside this shape.